Shivani, you've spoken about all of us, but I must tell the panel that Shivani herself is a lady of the arts. I've known her since childhood and an art impresario as well, and a beautiful human being. Shivani, it's a pleasure to see you here.
Thank you so much, Nisha. I feel so proud when you're out there in Bombay and all over with your outreach programs and putting Jammu on the map. And you know, even if people don't know that I belong to the state of J&K with my wazir, you know, with your Jamwal, your route is absolutely 100% clear. So thank you for being such an ambassador with the work you do, but also with the name you carry.
Thank you so much, Shivani.
So you've authored columns for international and Indian publications, as well as done television and art, lifestyle, design, and luxury. You authored two books on the traditional Indian crafts, and I think you've really been a trailblazer, being the first woman to win as a student leader from Delhi University. So that was really huge. And she's been seen as one of the most important influencers whose social media following is very impactful, not just to the Indian public, but also internationally. And therefore, your inputs on this whole viability factor are going to be quite considerable, because you are able to generate traffic and eyeballs towards brands with social media like few can. So we are really looking forward to, featuring on your blog archives, your Business India, Asian Age, You Think, Good Homes, Grazia, Law Fisher columns and articles. So
thank you so much. Thank you so much for that very glorious introduction. I can hardly recognize myself. But I had wanted to speak a little bit about the art market and how to encourage not only Jammu artists, but Indian artists into the field of, international art. But if you want me to go after Mr. Gandhi, I'm happy to do that.
Nisha, I just thought that we'll save the cherry on the cake for the last. And having said that, when there is someone who has had so much exposure and ability to really take things to an international platform, I thought that would be an interesting perspective. But we can, we can certainly have you first.
The only point, if I do have that moment that you've so kindly given me, Shivani, I do want to say that, there seems to be an elitism in the world of art in India. If you hold your wine glass right, or if you have, the Queen's accent, you are accepted by the gallerists in the world of art easier, projected better in the world of art internationally. And I would be a little politically incorrect by quoting, one of the film Bollywood actors in saying that there may also be some nepotism in the world of art. Why does an artist have to be, from the big cities? Why does an artist have to be articulate, and why does an artist have to be able to network and hold their champagne glasses right in order to make a headway and a foray into the world of art in India and then in the international art scenario? So first off, I think indigenous art, indigenous traditional art, and artists from tier two cities and tier three cities are as enthralling as our big city artists. So first off, if we were to use our prowess to tap into all artists, looking at their creativity rather than looking at how, well-groomed or how they are, how good their etiquette is, we would have a greater plethora of artists in India. The second thing that would make us big players in the international art market is authentication and provenance. If every artist was to sell his art with, a certificate and a stamp of his authentication, it makes the art, like I think it was Anuj and Mr. Amit who pointed out that, when you're doing the online game of selling, you need to have a trust, and to build trust, you need to have authentication certificates and provenance, which is very, very important, because we expect art to outlive the artist and to go like Walter Langhammer, like Nandlal Bose, like Rabindranath Tagore, we expect the art to go for generations beyond the artist. And of course, which is something which all of you have said, the time has come for online selling. So those artists that are not conversant with the web need to, you know, have gallerists who handhold them and take them to the next notch internationally. Because rather than, like Mr. Gandhi said, rather than having a 1% play in the international art market, we would, you know, have a much greater sway on the international art market. For instance, Moti Lal Karan, who was India's most brilliant Mithila artist, you know, had a museum in Japan. It's a different matter that, you know, they literally captured him and held him there, poor chap. But the fact is he had an avid fan following in Japan. A man who came from a little village in Madhubani managed to make it, or for that matter, Jaydev Baghel, who was a Bastar artist, who I have written a book on, sold in Germany. So, you know, it's just about the fourth and my last point, you know, since we have a paucity of time. You know, the last point is we need exposure and we need people, we need patrons, we like the Medicis of the Renaissance period. Artists are not salesmen, they're creative people. They should not be expected to go and peddle their work. It's very sad when they have to go to people's houses to sell art. And like Mr. Gandhi said, we are going through an economic slump. So the responsibility falls upon curators, consultants, hospitality, and people like us who are Shivani, who love art and who are patrons of art, to help these artists, to help our India reach an international world, because it depends upon us to make India Atmanirbhar. And what better time than now to help and handhold these artists to reach an international market? Thank you. I'm sorry I drove so fast through this, because it was all welling up in me while you were talking.